Welcome to Everyday Economics, a weekly podcast about the economics and daily life. I'm your host, Pooja Mehra.
For a variety of reasons, the rural economy is showing a recovery. It did not face as strict a lockdown as urban India did. Much of the meager government relief spending has been directed towards it. The monsoon rains are likely to have been a positive for farm produce, although it remains to be seen what will happen to farm incomes. These trends have generated the hope that the recovery in the rest of the economy can ride on the resilience of rural India. My guest this week is Chief India Economist, HSBC, Pranjal Bhandari. I asked Pranjal if the rural recovery is likely to sustain and if it can be relied upon to power the overall economic recovery. Welcome to Everyday Economics, Pranjal.
Thanks, Pooja. Great to be on your show.
Thank you. Let's start today by talking very briefly about the statistics. The National Statistics Office has just put out their GDP estimates for the April-June quarter, and it struck me that you have taken a contrarian view and you have said that the alternative statistics and sources of information that they have used to estimate growth of the informal sector may have captured the weakness better than what was originally expected. Most economists believe they may have underestimated, but you seem to suggest otherwise. Could you explain, how this has happened?
Yeah, sure. So, in the first quarter, growth was 23.9% contraction, and this was basically in line with our view. But what we had thought that, the statistics office will, in the beginning, announce a number closer to 17 to 18% contraction. And then later, when they get better data on the informal sector, they will revise it to a 25% like contraction. But in their first estimate, they came up with something like 25% contraction. And when we went into the details, we found that they were not able to get access to some data they always use, for example, on company returns, because a lot of the listings took more time this time because of the lockdown. So instead, they had to rely more on volume indicators, they had to rely more on conversations with professional bodies. And we think when you start relying more on volume indicators, then you end up capturing the informal sector a little bit better. So in that sense, I think the informal sector was captured a little bit better. Was it captured perfectly? No, I'm not really saying that. In fact, I believe that over time, this GDP number will be revised, but there are pressures of both it being revised upwards and revised downwards. So once they get the actual data on company listings, which we call value added, then there could be some upward pressure on the GDP number. But as soon as they get data on the full informal sector survey, then there could be a downward pressure. One scenario is that the two cancel out. My simple point is that the informal sector was a slightly better captured in this data than would have been the case had they stuck only to company data.
And statistics apart, I also wanted to ask you, and this is something which is not just true of the post-COVID period, but also I think even from the time demonetization happened, that one of the dynamics of the interaction between the formal segment of the economy and the informal segment of the economy is that the formal sector may be gaining market share at the expense of the informal sector because the informal sector is not able to cope with the distress. They may be folding up or losing business to the formal sector. Does that sort of place in a complicated way with the data, with the estimates? And also, what does it mean for the economy?
Well, I'm glad you asked that, and I think this whole formal versus informal distinction is very, very important to look into. Now, what we find is that informal sector firms generally have lower economic buffers. So, if they are faced with a situation in which business is not running, cash inflow is not coming in regularly, they sort of collapse faster than the formal sector. The death rate in informal sector is rather high, and anecdotally speaking, this is what we are perhaps seeing right now. A lot of the informal sector is extremely hurt at this point. And the formal sector, in turn, is gaining market share. So, for example, look at the results with Britannia. Very high sales. Perhaps some informal biscuit manufacturers had to shut shop during the lockdown. But does this formality stay on? Does it stick on? We saw the same thing during demonetization. We saw that formal sector companies were gaining market share, but 1 year down the line, we did not see this had sustained. We know that informal sector has a high death rate, but it also has a high birth rate. You know, a couple of quarters, perhaps a year down the line, they took rebirths, they came back into the business, and then we found that, you know, this formality didn't rise. I think there's one important takeaway from here. You know, any formalization that happens at the cost of really killing the informal sector doesn't really sustain, because the informal sector has a way of coming back. But if you have formalization, because you've changed the ecosystem and the informal sector is being able to graduate into formality, that sort of formalization, I think, has better chance to stick on, to survive. I'm not sure that the formalization we are seeing this time is that kind of formalization.
What you're saying is very important, because there's a qualitative difference between the kind of two formalizations that you've talked about, you're saying that when there is a natural organic growth of informal into formal, the economy naturally benefits from that, growth benefits from that, but when it happens artificially out of distress in one part of the economy, then it doesn't play out that well, right? That's what you're saying.
That's correct, yes.
And we do have some evidence of the second kind of formalization happening right now.
The one which is more distress-led?
Yeah.
Well, look, I think so. I think, you know, there is reason to believe that, you know, a lot of firms have had to fold business simply because their economic surplus, their buffers were not strong enough, and, you know, they had to shut shop.
I was planning to ask you later, but I think this is a good time to ask this question. Would it not have been, in that case, good for the policymakers to offer some kind of a lifeline to, these kind of informal firms? Should have been the primary way of extending relief to the economy against the COVID shock?
Well, it would have. The problem being that many of these informal sector firms may not have access to formal sources of finance, which is what, you know, policymakers control. So it may not have been perfect, but it still would have been useful. Now, one can argue that, the partial loan guarantee scheme, or rather the full loan guarantee scheme of 3 trillion rupees, was meant to do exactly that. But if you look at the offtake there, I think so far the offtake has been only about half the amount. And when you sort of probe bankers on that, I think the details that come out is that there is a lot of risk aversion. Despite it being fully guaranteed by the government, a lot of bankers are very unsure about giving out these loans. So that could be one thing at play. So the authorities could have helped. The way they have helped right now, however, has not worked out perfectly.
And could Mudra loans have been one channel of doing this?
Well, look, the Mudra loan route was there even before the pandemic. As in, that was there before, that is there now. That has always been there. The big question is, are banks ready to give out these loans? My own sense is that banks are extremely risk averse. Even before the pandemic, they were sitting on a huge stock of non-performing loans. Through this pandemic, it's likely to increase even further. You know, when you're so nervous about your books, about the asset quality, then I'm not sure you'll be very willing to make more loans, especially to small firms, especially to firms on whom you don't have too much faith.
And so now to come, to the rural recovery, there's a lot of hope riding on a quick rural recovery, given that rural India did not face as strict a lockdown as urban India did, given that much of the very small, but whatever government relief that has been provided from Delhi has been directed at rural India. Given that we've had a good monsoon and agriculture sector may be doing fine. The question is that, this rural recovery, how much can it be relied upon? Is it a robust enough rural recovery, or is it going to be sustained? how much of a factor is this going to be in the overall picture?
So there has been a lot of excitement about rural recovery in the last couple of months for all the, you know, reasons that you mentioned. The data shows that too. So, for example, you know, all the data we use as proxies for rural India, for example, industrial production of non-durable goods, they have done fairly well. If you look at rainfall data or reservoir levels, they are very good. If you look at sowing activities, it is at a record high. If you look at tractor sales, it's doing well. So all the data supports this entire rural recovery and rural growth theme. My problem here is that I am a bit nervous that it may not last a long time. And the reason is that it is benefiting from some short-run things like you mentioned. For example, it's benefiting from the government giving more money for things like PM Kisan, NREGA. It's benefiting from good rains this year. But once the excitement from that fades, then the old structural issues which rural India has been grappling with even before the pandemic will come on fore. And some of these are, you know, the fact that over time, rural Indians are far more dependent on construction sector than in the past. In fact, you know, about 30 years ago, 5% of rural labor force used to work in construction. And now about 20% of rural labor force works in construction. 70% of construction is real estate led. And real estate is very much dependent on shadow bank funding, on NBFC funding. At a time when India's shadow banks are troubled, real estate faces problems, and so does construction activity and all of the people who work in construction sites, most of them being rural Indians. So if construction is not doing well, that is really a drag on rural wage growth. So that's one sort of a issue that can come back into the fore. The second is rural indebtedness. You know, what we've been finding is that rural indebtedness has been growing, particularly the landed who have access to bank, you know, bank finance, bank loans. They have seen a huge increase in their indebtedness, and actually their real indebtedness has increased even more at a time when inflation has been weak. Now, these landed people give wages to the landless, and if the landed people are not doing well, then the wage they give is weak, and that's not great for rural wage growth. And finally, you know, one can argue that NREGA is important. The truth is that NREGA was very important at one point. In the last couple of years, you know, a lot of the research study that, you know, we have done ourselves and we look, you know, at other people's work, we find that NREGA is not such a big driver of rural wages anymore. Even now, although the government has really replenished NREGA coffers, the demand for the scheme is more than the supply. So I don't see that being a big driver of rural wages either. You know, all said and done, our sense is that once this current harvest season, you know, sowing, harvest, this huge activity, kharif season is over, then things could begin to slow in rural India.
I think I agree with you completely that even pre-COVID, the financial sector problems had spilled over into the real estate and construction sector, which had reduced probably demand for labor, which was essentially coming out of the rural areas. And because of that, the supply-demand dynamics of labor in rural areas may have changed, because of which NREGA may no longer be playing the role of providing a floor to rural wages. Mm-hmm. And also, you know, ensuring that distress migration of labor, I mean, they have an option. So probably both of these work in tandem and together. But even if one doesn't work, then the rural wages and labor market doesn't function to the benefit of rural labor. And right now, post-COVID, both sources of demand for these NREGA jobs may have risen because so many people have returned to villages. So when there are more people asking for those jobs, that will have naturally an impact on wage rates. And so to sum it all, what you're saying is that you're saying that rural incomes and therefore rural consumption may not be as strong as people are hoping for, which could mean that there would be a rise in rural indebtedness, which in turn means that the rural recovery is not going to be as strong as is being hoped for.
Yes, I think you're absolutely right there. And I just wanted to add one point here, which is that, I look at India as being a two-speed economy. For every sector that is doing well, another sector is not. So, for instance, in the last couple of months, rural has been doing well. Urban has not been doing very well. And, we've seen this across many cuts. But I also want to sort of warn that we really need to think where this is going to go. Generally, two-speed recoveries don't really work. At some point, they come together. And now we'll have to see how this one will come together. Will rural fall or will urban rise or a mix of the two? And I think that's going to be the key determinant of how GDP growth will be going forward.
So basically, you're saying that, the economy cannot run on just one engine. It needs sort of, both the wheels to work and complement each other. We can't rely on just, one part of the economy.
Yes, I'm saying that. And I also want to say one more thing, that there's actually a huge amount of interdependence between the two. So today, rural India can do well, but rural India depends a lot on urban Indian construction jobs, urban demand. So rural India can't indefinitely do well when urban is not doing well. Eventually, they have to meet somewhere. And the question is, where will they meet? Will they meet at a high point, or will they meet at a low point, or somewhere in the middle?
Right. And I want to now also bring in, your very fine analysis of looking at migrant labor, which is also a factor in rural wage, in determination of rural wages, partly because of construction workers, but also because how you separate out the migrant laborers between those who travel out of villages, out of distress, and those that are the aspirational labor. And this sort of also ties in with what you just said about how the rural economy and the urban economy are interdependent, which in which some economists also call the remittance economy. I wanted you to talk a little bit about the whole aspirational India growth story. What is happening to it right now and how it's going to play out. I myself, I'm worried. I don't know if you agree that, the aspirational India growth story was sort of so much dependent on the whole remittances economy, and it there may be a question mark right now on it.
Yeah, great questions, Pooja. So, what we've seen in this pandemic was, roughly about 30 million people went back home, the reverse migration from urban areas back to their homes in rural India. The big question then became, will they come back? Because urban India was seeing a huge shortage of labor. My sense is that most of them will want to come back. And this is how I think about it. When you break down why people migrate out of their homes in the first case, we find that about 60% of them are aspirations led. What really attracts them to move to urban India is this higher wage. Urban wages are about 2.5 times more than rural wage, and that's a lot. So in search of this wage, they actually go away to urban India. Right now, these people have gone home. But if rural wages remain weak, and that is our sense, we don't think rural wages are going to rise sustainably. If that is true, then at some point, these migrants who are aspirational will want to come back to their urban jobs. So in my sense, one of the big problems we face in the last couple of months is the labor shortage. I don't think the labor shortage will be our biggest worry a few months down the line. A lot of rural laborers will want to come back. The question will actually be the opposite. Will the returning labor find the job they initially had in urban India, or will they have to forcefully live in rural area, earning lesser wages than they would have aspired for? And my worry is that could happen. My sense is that the urban India jobs prospects is not looking very great. We saw this same thing happen during demonetization. On paper, when you looked at unemployment numbers, when you looked at jobs created, it seemed that everything was okay. But as soon as you split the numbers, you found that, almost 2 to 3 times of the jobs were created in rural India. A lot of people who would have wanted to work in urban India were not getting the jobs. And I fear something similar is going to happen this time too, that people may not be able to get the jobs they aspire for in urban India and may be forced to stick on in rural India. Also, if you sort of bring it together with the pandemic, you know, some of the permanent victims of pandemic are sectors such as hospitality, restaurants, tourism, which are very urban in nature. So if they are going to be hit for a long time, that's where most of your job losses will be. And eventually, all wages in India are a function of economic growth. If you think that the economic growth potential has fallen through this pandemic, which is something I think has happened, then that in itself is going to pull down both rural and urban wages. So putting this all together, my sense is India will not have a jobs problem. Most people on paper will be employed somewhere, but unfortunately, they will not be doing the jobs they would have liked to do. Many of them will be stuck in rural India, earning lower wages than they would have liked. And eventually, India will have a wage growth problem. And when wage growth is low, it keeps demand low, it keeps GDP low, and you're stuck in a low wage, low GDP equilibrium.
So what you've explained is that the shock from the COVID crisis, what it's probably going to do is actually reinforce and deepen a structural problem that in any case India was facing, which is of low job creation kind of GDP growth, where most people are they are underemployed. There is hidden unemployment. They may have jobs on paper, but these are not productive jobs. They don't get very good wages. Wage growth is not good, and therefore the economy is not able to get the kind of demand that it needs for high growth. And that's a very worrying thought.
Yes, it is. So then, of course, I'm sure your next question would then be, so what do you do about it? And I think, you know, all the reforms that can keep your GDP growth higher, that can attract investment, I think is what is needed, because investments eventually increases the capacity of your economy to grow and create new jobs. So anything that the policymakers can do in order to keep the investment cycle ticking or investments to rise is what will urgently be needed. As a sort of like a macroeconomist, from my perspective, I think we need to get a few important reforms done, which aid organic, gradual, and automatic sort of formalization of the economy, which I think is very critical for having good quality, sustainable jobs over time. And then, of course, investment, as I told you, both the central government, state government, private sector, public sector enterprises, they all have to help in this whole investment cycle so that investment keeps ticking. From the COVID period, one thing has come up. You know, I think what COVID will leave behind is some sectors which will be sort of the dead sectors, and some sectors which will be the alive and kicking sectors. And the big challenge for policymakers will be, how do you reallocate capital? India has a limited amount of savings. How do you take it away from sectors that are not working and put it to sectors that are working, which can continue to grow, which can continue to invest, and over time continue to create high quality jobs? So any sort of like a mechanism that reallocates capital is probably the one of the most urgent needs of the day. And here I just wanted to bring one point in. You know, the IBC, the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code, it's a huge reform we did in the last couple of years, completely geared for doing exactly this. How do you reallocate capital from one bunch of sectors to another bunch of sectors? Unfortunately, when it was needed most, we sort of suspended it and put it in cold storage.
True. Not just from one sector to the other sector, but also from borrowers and defaulters who are unlikely to be able to return their loans to those, you know, who, if given a loan, have a better chance of using it for growing their firms and contributing to investments and the economy, and also then therefore repaying those loans. The financial and the banking sector's health, which is right now a great risk that even the RBI itself has flagged. That becomes a very important factor, right? Probably the most important factor.
Yes, Ayon, that is exactly how I'm thinking about it. You know, this whole concept of potential growth, it's a concept which which people find very appealing for emerging markets like India. You know, a lot of the investments we've been getting over the last couple of decades is because people perceive India to be a high potential growth economy. About 10, 12 years ago, we used to talk about it being a 8% economy. You know, if you look at that metric, I think it has been falling over the last decade. On the eve of the pandemic, I would say that India's potential growth was at 6%. And my worry is, by the time the pandemic is behind us, potential growth would have fallen by 1 percentage point more towards 5%. And what could drive this fall in potential growth over the pandemic period? So there are sort of three sort of things that can drive. One is labor shortage. Second is logistics. And the third is funding. Now, the fact that a lot of labor have gone back home is a big constraint right now. You know, people are not getting the labor they want in factories. But as I had explained earlier, I think most of these laborers will want to come back very soon because rural wages will not rise, you know, sustainably. So I don't think labor constraint will stick on. The second is logistics. The fact that, you know, because of the lockdowns, there is a lot of supply side disruption. People are not being able to source raw material, not being able to access final markets easily. But I would imagine that as the lockdown eases, we go back to normal, even that constraint will go. The third constraint is funding, you know, getting money to run your business, you know, money as your working capital or what have you. And I think that is going to be the biggest problem and the problem that actually sticks on for the longest. You see, Indian corporates are far more dependent on bank credit than they are dependent on other sources of credit. And if banks are risk averse, they have too much of non-performing loans, which only rise over time, then they don't want to give out that much credit. You know, they are risk averse. They don't want to take on risk and give out more credit to different players. And when when the economy doesn't get access to this bank funding, then who funds growth? And if you don't fund growth, you don't see that growth. And your potential growth actually begins to fall. So we think that the fall in potential growth that we'll see, you know, that we are seeing through this pandemic period is led by the financial sector and more so risk-averse banks.
And a lot of people hold the view that actually the biggest constraint is the balance sheet of the government. The fact that they don't have the fiscal space to give a spending push. How much of a role does that play in your analysis if it is actually banks which are the main constraint?
Yeah, so look, you know, a very simple way to put it is that if you ever look at investment and slice it between government and private, you'll find that government investment is only 20 to 25% of overall investment. The remaining 75 to 80% is actually private sector. So eventually, you want to have a kind of growth which is not too dependent on government, because even if the government is working perfectly, very efficiently, spending a lot, being able to borrow, you know, without creating any havoc in the market, it can only provide you that much growth. It's at the end of the day only 20-25% of the pie. The bigger player is the private sector. You need to create an environment in which even the private sector is being able to function, because that can get you the largest growth.
Right. And even sometimes people pay a lot of importance to foreign investments. But I think foreign investments are not that big a chunk of the pie either. It's actually the domestic investments and domestic savings.
Yeah, that's right. Look, so far, the role of foreign investment in India, it's growing quite rapidly, especially, in fact, you know, even through the pandemic, we've seen a big rise in FDI. So it is definitely growing. But it is a small share, you know, it's domestic savings, domestic investment which is, you know, the bigger chunk.
So to sum up, you know, towards the end, we have in the past many years relied on consumption as the savior of Indian growth. After COVID, we thought that we could rely on rural consumption. There's a lot of exuberance around that line of thinking. But as you've explained, that may not sustain. The reason being the wage movements both in rural India and urban India, and you've explained how both are linked and interconnected, in fact. And so you're suggesting that the best way to ride out of this problem of low growth, this risk, and avert this risk of low growth is to make sure that, you know, we don't get stuck in a low wage, low GDP growth phase. And the best way to do that is to make sure that investments take place and therefore productive jobs are created and wages remain protected. And the main constraint in doing that, you've explained, is the financial sector, because most of this takes place when private companies invest and private companies rely on bank finance for investments. Did I sum up what you said correctly?
Yeah, that was fantastic.
Do you want to add something?
One extra point if I can make here, which is the fact that, we need one more thing to work out for us, which is that we do rules-based policymaking. That is very important for countries like India, which are still emerging markets, to gain credibility. We have a few rules that we came out with over the last decade or so. You know, we had fiscal rules on monetary policy. We had inflation targeting. GST was a rule on indirect taxation. IBC was sort of rules-based policy making for, resolution of bad assets. My sense is that we should not give away these rules or relax them too much just because we are being faced with a pandemic. We should work with these rules, try to make it flexible, but we should work within these rules, because that's the only way we'll come out of the pandemic with far more credibility than we entered into the pandemic with. At this point, giving out these rules and basically bringing in more and more discretion into policy making will hurt us in the long run.
I'll only add to that. So the whole customs duty and, now we are even talking about import licensing, that also sort of fits into with what you're saying. It gives discretion to policymakers, some bureaucrats sitting somewhere in government making these decisions on a company to company or a sector to sector basis, depending on who's able to lobby the government better. Instead of that, there should be predictability, which is something that the government and the chief economic advisor himself has been saying in his economic surveys. And as you're saying, we need to, like all advanced economies of the world are, we need to quickly, in fact, increase the pace at which we become rules-led, rather than regress back to discretion-led.
That's correct, yes.
Thanks so much, Pranjal.
Great. Thanks for having me on the show, Pooja. It was really fun.